Welcome to Fiction, Faith and Familiar Themes, a conversation about watching what we watch, listen to and read through gospel lenses. We're going to be looking at popular movie tropes, narrative devices and the go-to plot points from pop culture, movies, TV shows, books and everything else over the summer. Our theme tonight is resurrection and I'm joined by Rachel, Lynsey and Matthew.
Hi, Matthew. Like a disembodied head.
Floating around.
And we're going to be looking at the theme of resurrection. A few caveats. No Aslans. The gospel lenses that you need for watching Aslan and Narnia aren't very thick. So we're going to skip right past that one. That's an obvious. And for Matthew's sake, no Passion of the Christ, because that doesn't count as fiction.
That would have been an easy one. Because I'm struggling with all the other films.
Okay, well, we'll kick things off and we'll let Rachel go first with her movie.
So this is one of my favourites. I know it's definitely one of Lindsay's favourites as well. I love Lord of the Rings.
Yay!
I thought I would pick Gandalf for my example of the resurrection trope.
Who are you? Show yourself! It cannot be. Forgive me. I mistook you for Saruman.
I am Saruman. Rather Saruman as he should have been.
You fell.
Through fire. And water. From the lowest dungeon to the highest peak, I fought him the Balrog of Morgoth. At last, I threw down my enemy and smote his ruin upon the mountainside. Darkness took me, and I strayed out of thought and time. The stars wheeled overhead, and every day was as long as a life age of the earth. It was not the end. I felt life in me again. I've been sent back until my task is done.
Gandalf.
Gandalf? Yes. That was what they used to call me. Gandalf the Grey. That was my name.
Gandalf.
I am Gandalf the White. And I come back to you now. At the turn of the tide.
So, for anyone who hasn't seen Lord of the Rings before, I'll give you a wee quick rundown of the plot. I'm just going to have to run through this really quick. So Gandalf is...
It's a 9-hour movie.
condensing. So Gandalf's one of the last of the wizards to appear in Middle-earth, and they were commanded to aid the men and the elves and the dwarves. So Gandalf is a good and wise wizard, and he's one of the members. He's actually really the leader of the Fellowship of the Ring. This is a group whose quest it is to take the evil One Ring to Mordor to be destroyed in Mount Doom where it was forged. And that is how they stop Sauron, who's the evil guy, because he would want to use the ring to take over Middle Earth. So he's back. So they want to stop him. So the Fellowship of the Ring, they travel on this long, dangerous journey to Mordor. And Saruman is an evil wizard, and he tries to stop them. So he causes this storm on the mountain that they're on, and this forces them to travel actually down through the mines of Moriah, which is quite a scary, dark place. And the group then, they're attacked by orcs, who are like these evil big goblin creatures, big ugly fellas. And they chase them, but then they're scared off by a Balrog, which is a demon of the elf world, in Gandalf's word. So the group, they run to the bridge of Khazad-dûm, and they get across it, but Gandalf stops in the middle to stop the Balrog crossing and killing them. So he fights off the Balrog, and he has his big staff, and he breaks the bridge while shouting the most epic line in the film, "You shall not pass!" But actually in the book it's, "You cannot pass." The Balrog falls into the pit, but then his big fiery whip catches Gandalf around the ankles and pulls him down into the pit too. And the Fellowship are devastated because they see their friend die, but they had to leave and continue the journey in their quest to destroy the ring. So for me, and for all the ones who were watching it in the cinema who hadn't read the books, we thought that was it and that Gandalf was gone. But then in the second film, the Two Towers, Aragorn and Gimli and Legolas are looking for Merry and Pippin in the forest, and they see this man in white approaching, and they think it's Saruman, the evil wizard, and they go to attack him, but then it's revealed that it's Gandalf back from the dead. Whoa! So Gandalf, and he explains that he ended up continuing to fight the Balrog when he'd fallen down, and then he killed him, but then he died as well. And he described it as, "Darkness took me and I strayed out of thought and time. And then I felt life in me again. And I've been sent back until my task is done." And so his task was to save Middle Earth. So he became Gandalf the White and a lot more powerful. And it's all good then. So there's a few similarities between Gandalf and Jesus. So Gandalf, the leader of the Fellowship, he's the wise one who guided and protected them. And I thought that's kind of similar to, Jesus is the Good Shepherd in Psalm 23. And Jesus was the leader of the disciples as well. And they were traveling around too because they had the mission of preaching the good news. And Gandalf is a wizard, very powerful, and Jesus revealed his power and all the miracles they did, healing the sick and feeding the 5,000 and so on. Gandalf fights the Balrog and he says, "This foe is beyond any of your foes, beyond any of you." He shows that he's the only one who can defeat him, and he's prepared to make a sacrifice to save his friends. And Jesus showed by his death on the cross that he was the only one who could defeat Satan, just like, go right back to the start of the Bible in Genesis 3:15. He fulfills that prophecy of Eve's offspring crushing the snake's head. So Jesus defeating Satan. And Gandalf could only save his friends physically, but Jesus died to save us spiritually and to set us free from our sin and separation from God. And then when Gandalf dies, the Fellowship are devastated, and the task of destroying the ring, it seems really hopeless, seems like all hope is lost. And then this is like the disciples as well, after Jesus died, and they're all devastated too, and it all seemed hopeless without him. But then when Gandalf and Jesus come back to life, they bring hope again. And also there's a similarity of, like, you know, how those guys mistook Gandalf for Saruman, and Mary mistakes Jesus for the gardener, but they're who they say they are. And then there's just one more difference I can think of between Gandalf and Jesus, that Gandalf he said he was being sent back until his task was done, and his task was to save Middle-earth from being taken over by Sauron. But Jesus rose again to show that his task was already done, because he said it is finished on the cross, and that meant that he had already defeated Satan, and he defeated sin and death forever. And the disciples needed to see that Jesus really was the Son of God, and that was proved by his resurrection. So he had to show them that he was the Messiah that's promised the whole way throughout the Bible, and as he says at the end of Luke, and then they go and tell that to the rest of the world. So that's all my thoughts on Gandalf and Jesus, and I hope it all made sense. I'm gonna drink some tea now.
Annie's closed in white at the end.
Yeah, white. But I bet, like, if you compared the glow of Gandalf and Jesus, I think Jesus would have the brighter glow.
You think it's a more wattage?
Yes. if that's what a holy glow is measured in, yeah.
A holy glow.
I think that's what Peter said.
Well, like, that's not any less more stupid than what he said.
Kernsey's got a big of a whole bit of a holy glow there going on.
Been
up on the mountain.
Yeah. Go watch Lord of the Rings. It's 9 hours of your life well spent.
Unless you watch the extended version. Like 9 hours. Then it's like 11.
It's 11 hours of your life well spent.
Why do you think Gandalf had to die when he fought the Balrog? Why couldn't he just beat him and keep going? Do you think there's a reason that it was he had to die and come back from death, or even fall down the pit, defeat him, and then join them again? Why death?
The way he describes the Balrog, it seemed like it was something really evil, and the fact that, you know, nobody else could have defeated it, it seemed like there was that big sacrifice that needed to be made to make sure that it was properly killed. And
okay, so like the weight of the challenge?
Yeah, I think so.
And then coming back from the dead after that?
Yeah, it's like, this is a confession, I haven't really read the books properly, I've kind of skimmed them. But, you know, it talks about how there are I think it's the Vatar, I don't know if I'm pronouncing any of these things right.
Oh, you're talking about Gandalf?
That's Texas word. The Vatar, I think, they're like these supreme beings that are like even above Gandalf. Like, he's from this wizard race is sent back, you know, so he's been sent back to finish what he started, sort of thing. So we had to kind of see it through, and then I don't know what happens to him after the end of the film. So just...
Yeah, and then that scene when he does come back in the forest, you know, there's a kind of a blend between a Saruman and a Gandalf voice, and you're not really sure who it is, because yeah, if you haven't read the books, you don't know that he's coming back. He's gone. He's, you know, fly, you fools, and he's away. And Saruman's not dead at that stage, sure he's not. So it looks like, oh no, things have gone from bad to worse, and now they've been caught by Saruman, and then it's Gandalf.
Yeah,
with his hair straightened.
I know, really straight hair. He's like, I want to know his secret, how to get the hair that straight.
Flipping right, 29th of August, that's the look I'm going for. Can you do me like Gandalf?
Maybe he's worth it.
Oh, great.
He says, I am what Saruman could have been. Can I just rewatch these clips and trying to refresh on my head. But so yeah, kind of like if Saruman hadn't been tempted to over to the dark side, for some way of putting it, you know, he could have helped them. So, well, like he was being such a big obstacle because he was making all the orcs and this big orc army of who were terrorizing them. But yeah, I think Tolkien definitely meant Gandalf to be. He kind of has like a few figures who could relate to Jesus in different ways, like Frodo and Sam. You know, there's lots of heroes in the film, like so. There's lots of comparisons to be made there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're just great. Super.
Yeah, so there we go. Lord of the Rings. I think this is the second week we've had Lord of the Rings on. We had Boromir's death on last week, so check out that if you haven't seen that already.
That's okay. Also really sad.
Isn't it? Yeah, the pincushion. right, well, we jump on to our next movie / TV show / book / whatever you're picking, Lindsay.
We got a bit of Disney Plus for lockdown, so my movie is Frozen. My resurrected character then is Anna.
Olaf.
Or Olaf.
Oh, you're not doing Olaf. You're the snowman. You're such a wee lad.
I thought you got the sisters mixed up. I was like...
Well, Frozen 1, it's Anna. Anna.
Anna.
Anna.
Anna. Anna. Nah. Anna. I'm just going to go with the Belfast Anna.
Frozen. Freezing.
She is bangered, that wee doll. Absolutely.
Too cold.
Well, isn't it her in the first one and then in the second? Oh, yeah. People might not have seen the second one, but in the second one.
Sure. Elsa. Rachel spoiled three movies there in the last bit. So.
But to be fair, it's been 20 years.
But to be fair, though, the worst one probably is Olaf. That's the most heartbreaking. But anyway, the one I chose was Anna in the first Frozen. So I love that movie because they talk the whole way through. Anna gets zapped with an ice blast. Thing.
Yep, that's
and
true.
And then her hair, like, oh no, her hair's already got that wee stripe. But then she gradually gets colder and colder and colder and colder until she's almost frozen. And then Elsa comes to save her, and Hans is about to finish Elsa off. And then Anna steps in and she takes the final blow for her sister. And they have said the whole way through the movie that only an act of true love can actually help Anna. Who is gradually, slowly freezing. But Elsa, it's the sort of love between the two sisters that actually is the kind of resurrection part there, I think. And then it all...
Yeah, she properly dies, because I think you see, like, her last breath fly out of her.
Yeah. And then she... Whatever it is there a teardrop or something? Or have I made that up? A teardrop lands on
it her. Sounds like it, doesn't it?
No,
it sounds Disney. Like Disney, yeah.
Could be making that up. But I think there's a teardrop from Elsa onto Anna, and then she like gets better and it's all fine.
Yeah, because I think it's the act of true love that can save Anna. And Kristoff's looking for her, and if he finds her, that the presumption is that's the true love's kiss. But she, not deliberately avoids him, but pursues Elsa to save her at the cost of not finding Kristoff in time.
Yeah.
So there's self-sacrifice.
And I had not considered that. I hadn't considered that was like a deliberate...
You know, because he's in the mist, the frozen mist, and he's looking for her to be the Prince Charming.
Yeah.
Elsa's about to be whacked.
Yeah.
By Hans.
Such a villain.
Yeah. Scumbag.
Chancellor, like.
And then, yeah, so Anna steps in to prevent the sword hitting her.
Yeah.
As she, it's now too late for her.
Yeah.
Yeah. And yes, the act of true love saves her.
Yeah.
It's kind of like, you know, all the Disney films, you're so used to seeing that kind of like, oh, like the guy will come in and save the girl and that'll be all good. But it's nice to see something different. That, like, it's a sister seeing another sister and showing how that family love is so important as well, and sacrificial as well.
Yeah.
But
I love that. I love the twist in it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Oh,
that's what it was. I thought that was really clever.
And so it's the act of sacrifice that causes the resurrection then. Her willingness to give her life means that she can pick it up again, to paraphrase Jesus.
There you go.
Mm-hmm.
There you go. I had thought about this for hours, but I hadn't thought about those things.
You were just focusing on the Disney storyline.
You were just singing Let It Go, Lindsay, let's be honest.
Soundtrack.
You were washing your dishes and mouthing Let It Go.
Yeah.
I do love those movies.
But I think it's this idea that death is something that can be overcome with an act of love. You know, that love in that sense is stronger than death. And the love that's defined, especially in Frozen, maybe more so than other Disney movies, is self-sacrifice. It's self-giving. It's not the mushy-gushy, someday my prince will come, but it's I will, at my own cost, give myself for the greater good of someone else. And that act defies death, which is internal and inward looking and self-preservation. And so you get this act where Anna steps in front of Elsa so she doesn't die, even though it means that she will be frozen, and she knows that. And it cannot remain. It's the death cannot hold them kind of stuff. It has no power. Oh, death, where is your sting? And other Bible verses.
Yeah.
Isn't it interesting, though, how, like these things sort of come up across films in general? Like, it's always sort of the same thing of, like, unless it's, like, a really morbid rubbish film, there's always, like, some element of hope attached to it, whether that be through, like a champion or something coming to set people free, or... you know, in the likes of that film where, you know, the act of love is overpowering and outweighing the act of death, which allows life to sort of flourish. And interestingly, like, that's the theme. There's always some sort of arc of that in most film series throughout culture. You know what I mean?
Well, you did say at the start of this, you don't understand what we're doing here. That's exactly what we're doing here. It's this idea of, why do these themes and tropes keep popping up in these movies that are, they're not Christian movies, but what is it that's deep down within us, like, we keep getting drawn into these same story beats, that we can't help but think that there is a chosen one, there is something in a sacrificial death, there is something about resurrection. You know, I mean, maybe not a good example of this is Brendan Fraser's The Mummy, with that refrain throughout the whole movie is, death is not the end. You know, which we can completely agree with and say, yeah, well, that's true. Not in the sense of, like, a mummified zombie. But
this is a bit of a rogue example, Stephen.
Yes, it is.
Freaks me out. Do get them.
What's your movie then, Matthew?
Marvel, The last one, Endgame.
Marvel, the last one. That's such a movie.
I don't Endgame. Think there will be a last one.
Marvel, the last one.
Well, that's true, yeah. Well, I suppose it's sort of a combination between the last one and the one before the last one.
that's what it was called Infinity as well. War.
Infinity War and the Endgame. And it's sort of to do with how your big man Thanos, you know, comes along and, you know, and he sort of in the first last one, what do you call it?
Infinity War,
you said it.
He sort of gives off, you know, the impression that he's won and he's done what he said he was going to do, which was kill half the boys in the universe, which obviously isn't ideal. He seemed to have his intentions he thought were good, but like they weren't. They were pretty rubbish. Hmm. And then the second one focuses on how the Avengers sort of go about reversing that process, and like it is quite interesting. What I find interesting about it is throughout the Infinity War and the latter end of the sort of the Endgame, your man Stephen Strange, he's able to zoop into the future and see what the crack is. He's yep. able to sort of tell, you know, there's some things which sort of go against logic. Like he gives Thanos this little stone, which is sort of what you'd be like, why are you doing that? That's a really stupid thing to do. But you know, because Stephen Strange can see into the future, he knows it's the right thing to do, and it's almost sort of reflective of, you know, the when Christ knows that he's going to suffer, you know, he's like, I have to do this, but, you know, it seems like so much pain and so much struggle to those around me at the time, but because he is Christ and he is Jesus, he knows that that's the only way to ultimately, you know, save humanity, you know, which reflects quite well with the knowledge of Doctor Strange.
Yeah, I suppose that's like when Jesus says that he's going to die and Peter's like, no. That's the same reaction that you see with Iron Man. He's like, why would you give that up?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's cool. But Resurrections, do you want to get the...
Oh, I flipped.
Talking about Resurrections. So
what happens next is the boys manage to reverse it, and then it's sort of, once they get the stones and they reverse the process of sort of the extinction, you see this final big battle, which entails the light, the good side, and the dark side, and the light side have just been resurrected. I don't know, and I always sort of thought there was a bit of a parallel between the power of the light side showing there and how the resurrection power is sort of certified victory, in the sense that when you're watching that film, you always know that they're going to win, because mm-hmm. you know, there's the resurrection has happened, you know, following this terrible sort of turn of events, or what appeared to be a terrible turn of events, but was actually the plan the whole time, you know, and death will now be defeated, you know, that kind of way.
Hmm. Yeah, because you have that moment with Iron Man and Spider-Man when they reunite, mm-hmm. and he's a bit freaked out about what's happened, and he's been brought back. And it is, yeah, there is a resurrection. They're brought back from non-existence,
mm-hmm.
which is maybe worse than death.
Yeah.
They were like Olaf. They were all flirty too.
You're still making the big parallels here.
Yeah. Did you know that the exact moment that Olaf flurried was the same moment that Thanos snapped?
I know. Well, to be fair, that would make sense, provided that, you know, Olaf is real.
That would be amazing. I love those films, but I'm really struggling to remember what happened. There was a big time travel thing, wasn't there? And
yeah, that's the one.
They had a go. Gotta get the stones at a certain point in time or something.
Mm. Cynically, I think you could say, you know, they're always going to bring everybody back, especially in superhero movies. No one stays dead.
Hey, hang on a minute. No, hold your horses, because quite a few people did die in that Marvel film there.
Oh,
Black Widow.
Black Widow.
Iron Man.
Tone Iron Man. Iron Man.
Iron Man.
Iron Man.
Iron Man.
Iron. And there was someone else. Was there not another one?
Gamora. But then she came back. Yeah. Oh, yeah, Vision.
So, no, Stephen.
Okay. All right, fine.
And Loki? Loki dies?
He's been a dodgy character, like, that's.
But then they get him from another timeline.
Oh, does he come back?
Well, he stole the Tesseract.
So much I've forgotten. I need to watch it again.
My favorite bit. No, go ahead, Matthew.
Well, I was just going to say they're making a
Loki TV
Black
show.
Widow prequel. So technically it's not over, even though it's from before. So it is. But.
My favourite bit in that movie is where it's Cap standing and everything looks like it's just over, just looks like the worst has happened, and then you just hear and you left and you left
on your left.
And then they all just start coming out of all the portals. It's just, it is absolutely so uplifting. I love it. Yeah. And it is just, you, like, watching it. I love those movies, but before those Marvel movies, I had never really watched superhero movies very much. So I didn't really know what to expect.
Mm-hmm.
And you do just think, oh, like, there's, how can they come back from this? This is horrendous. It's all over. It's been totally flattened. And then all of a sudden, actually, hey ho, no, it's class. It's great. It's a great moment. Great movie moment. I love it.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, it's not.
And then they save the day.
Well, and then, well, I don't then watch it. We've watched it loads of times here, and we don't then really watch it to see Tony Stark dying.
that's like
there.
Such a sad scene, but it's also really cool.
Well, that was my sacrificial death from last week.
Oh,
so if you haven't watched that, go and watch that.
Sacrificial death is such an easy topic compared to resurrection.
Oh, like, sorry.
Whoever was in that had such an easy ride. I was honest, I was proper, like, I don't know what to do with this. Changing my topic 3 minutes before the
right, well, I'll jump to my one. Mine's a slightly different resurrection. I'm going with Beauty and the Beast. At the end of Beauty and the Beast, Gaston?
No one, something like Gaston.
No one spits like Gaston. When he was a child, he had 4 dozen eggs. But now that I'm a man, I eat 8. So he stabs the beast. Kill the beast. I know all these songs. They're brilliant. And the beast is dying, but also the rose, the magical beast-defying rose is drooping and dying and wilting. And the last petal's about to fall off. And if it falls off, it's game over. And he's also been stabbed by Gaston, because no one stabs like Gaston.
No one stabs like
and he dies. He's done. And he dies, the petal falls, but Belle has fallen in love with this grotesque, barbaric beast man. And the act of her falling in love, and I think we have magical tears here again. But the magical, the magical tears she cries, showing her true love, and that brings the beast back to life.
I came back. I couldn't let them. Oh, this is all my fault. If only I'd gotten here sooner.
Maybe. It's better. It's better this way.
Don't talk like that. You'll be all right. We're together now. Everything's going to be fine. You'll see.
And at least I got to see you one last time.
Please, please don't leave me. I love you.
But in this resurrection, he's not just resurrected to the beast form, but he's transformed as well into his human prince. Does he have a name? The prince. transformed into Prince Beast. I think he's just called human now.
Human one.
Prince human. And so there's a sense here of, rather than the likes of Gandalf and even Anna to an extent, and the superheroes, where they're resurrected to finish the mission, to do a job, to defeat death. This is more of a passive resurrection. He is resurrected through the love of someone else. And I thought there's parallels here akin to our resurrection hope that we have, that because of Christ's great love for us, we will be resurrected and transformed and glorified. And it's the act of Bell's love for this gruesome beast that brings life from death and transforms from hideousness into a man with flowing locks.
A bit like Gandalf.
With straight hair. And I think there's a sense of being resurrected rather than self-resurrecting or the need for them to defeat death, but death having been defeated for them. I think there's a picture there of the church of Christians being resurrected, and the idea that because of someone, it's the same thing in that sense of someone's love is more powerful than death, and Bell's love brings back Beast. It's slightly different from the other resurrections that we tend to default to, but it's, I think it's there's a nice picture there of the church, of Christians, Christian hope of being resurrected. So my question is, very quickly then as we finish, why do we keep having stories that go to resurrection? Because it's, I mean, even historically, it's a bit of a far-fetched one. It's a hard truth to get your head around that someone was dead and came back. Why are we so attracted to these stories?
Because we're a society who are desperate for hope and obsessed with finding ultimate satisfaction. And I think society is moving in such a way that people are desperate to find sort of satisfaction, identity and image in material and temporary places. And I think that's reflected in the way that film and media sort of comes out you know, there is hope after death, you know, this isn't it, you know, this, you know, people don't want this existence just to be it, because this world's difficult and hard and there's challenges and people want more. And I think that all just overflows into so many areas of life, media just being one of them and film just being one of them. But obviously, as Christians, we know that ultimate satisfaction can be found in trusting your life to Christ and finding that ultimate peace, joy, and satisfaction, and ultimately having a never-ending hope that, you know, someone has gone and defeated death so that we have eternal life.
It's good.
I think, like, you know, because I think people see how sacrifice is so important, and but yeah, as Mahi's saying there, like, there's so much hope, and that, yeah, that the sacrifice shows the depth of the love and the importance of that. But by bringing them back to life again, it's like, oh, but yeah, it ends on a happy note. You have the sacrifice, but you have the hope at the end as well. Of like, yes, we can leave it on happy, because we don't like tragedy, and we don't like to feel like sad. Well, I prefer a happy film to a sad one. So a happy story to a sad one, and I mean, you can't get any happier than the gospel.
So it's looking for the reward then. It's the sacrifice without the tragic cost.
Yeah. Yes. And but yet I think as Christians we do have to acknowledge that there was the cost for Jesus as well, but it's not a tragedy, because all our hope is in him. So, yeah, we have that tragedy of Good Friday, but yet it wasn't the end. So, yeah, that makes any sense. But we have to have Easter Sunday.
Any thoughts, Lynsey?
Yeah, I think I'm probably with Matthew on that one. It's looking for hope in a very dark place. And as humans, death is the final, you know, the final full stop. And I think a lot of people don't want to believe that. They maybe don't necessarily want to believe in God, or that, you know, they have a part to play in considering that and what it means for their lives. But I think, you know, even atheists, a lot of atheists are said to, you know, to on their deathbed really struggle to believe that that is the end, you know. And I think, you know, in funerals even, you know, people don't, even people who are non-believers don't want to be left with a, this is it, our loved one's gone, and that's the end. But, you know, there needs to be a hope beyond that. And
it's almost like we can't believe that it would just finish with death.
Yeah. There's hope for more, and we're made for more.
Yeah, I think there's a deep-rooted truth. I think Romans talks about it being suppressed, that we're not finite. There is something eternal about creation and humanity, and so to be snuffed out at death for, you know, what, 60, 70, 80 years or less seems illogical. There has to be more. It is that the mummy of death is not the end, can't be, doesn't make any sense. That's the illogical conclusion. It's unreasonable to think that death is the end of it. And so death is a reality, but these stories where death is overcome, yeah, triggers hope, inspires hope. Yeah.
Cool. Thank goodness.
Absolutely. Thank you for watching this video of, what's this called again? Fiction, Faith, and Familiar Themes. Next week, we will have another familiar theme with some more familiar cases. Thanks for watching.